I'd like to welcome everyone, graduates. It is an honor to celebrate this special achievement with you and your family and friends. It seems fitting that we take a moment to pause and reflect on all that you have gone through in getting to this special day. I ask everyone to join us in a moment of silence to use as a time to reflect and to offer thanks. Thank you. At this time, if you'll remain standing for our national anthem, performed by our own vocal rhapsody under the direction of Karen Dale.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land.
You may have a seat. First of all, thank you to Director Karen Dale and Vocal Rhapsody Singers. We appreciate you very much. Thank you again. As the president of Cleveland State Community College and on behalf of the faculty and staff, I would like to welcome you to this special day for the college. Today marks the 50th commencement ceremony at Cleveland State Community College. Since the founding of the college in 1967, we have provided credit and non-credit classes to well over a quarter of a million students. This ceremony will be broadcast live on our website. It will be archived and can be viewed later also by going to the Cleveland State website. DVD copies will be available at no charge in the Cleveland State Library 2 weeks from today. In order to help us facilitate this special event, we ask that all family and friends remain in the stands throughout the entire ceremony. We'd also like to request that you silence your cell phones at this time. Now I'd like to introduce my distinguished colleagues who are with me on the stage today. First, to my left, Dr. Denise King, Vice President for Academic Affairs. Next to her is Amy Carlilios, President of the Cleveland State Foundation. Dr. Michael Stokes, Vice President for Student Services, and Ms. Serena Young, President of the Staff Senate. And on my right, Regent Howard Roddy from the Tennessee Board of Regents, Ruth Kirkendall, our keynote speaker today, one of them, and Mr. Mark McLeod, our other keynote speaker and President of our Faculty Senate. Last but not least, Dr. Tommy Wright, our Vice President for Institutional Advancement. At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce some very special visitors with us today. I would also like to recognize Mr. Ron Ingram, the husband of our speaker, Ruth Kirkendall, who is with us today, as well as Audrey Key, Kelly McLeod, the wife of our other keynote speaker, Mark McLeod. Would you please stand and be recognized? We want to thank you for being with us here today. Cleveland State has been recognized as a veteran-friendly college. We're very proud of that. So first, I'd like to recognize any veterans who are in our graduating class today. If you'd please rise and be recognized. Thank you for your service. And also, anybody in our faculty, staff, or audience who are veterans of our armed services or active duty, would you please stand and be recognized? Thank you all for your service. At this time, Howard Roddy has some words of welcome from the Tennessee Board of Regents. Mr. Roddy?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. It is truly a pleasure to be with you today and to bring greetings on behalf of the Tennessee Board of Regents and our chairman, the Honorable Governor Bill Haslam. The Tennessee Board of Regents is the state university and college system of Tennessee, the governing body for Cleveland State and the 12 other community colleges, 6 comprehensive universities, and the 27 Tennessee Colleges of Applied Technology. Serving almost 190,000 students across the state of Tennessee this year, the Tennessee Board of Regents is currently one of the largest governing systems of higher education in the United States. I'm truly honored to be a member of the Tennessee Board of Regents, and today is one of the most priceless occasions for me as a regent, when I have the opportunity to engage directly with students and families at our campus. I am truly blessed to have a chance to serve each of you, but I am more rewarded by this occasion to see the celebration of each of you achieving your goals today. The credentials you're receiving mark an important achievement in your life, but it also has an important impact on our state. Governor Haslam has challenged our state with a critical mission, the Drive to 55, an effort to increase the number of Tennesseans who have earned a post-secondary credential like you're doing today. This is not just a mission for higher education, but a mission for workforce and economic development in Tennessee. A drive to improve the quality of life that we all enjoy. Our community colleges play a very important role in that effort by providing access to quality programs, stellar faculty, and unique opportunities in our local communities. And because of you and your success at Cleveland State, we are one step closer to reaching the Drive to 55 goal for all of Tennessee. So without further ado, on behalf of the Tennessee Board of Regents, please accept our sincere congratulations and warmest wishes that today is only the first step in achieving a lifetime of hopes and dreams. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. A couple of quick announcements. Phi Theta Kappa, the Community College National Honor Society, is selling roses in the lobby. The funds raised will go to the local Omega Omicron chapter of PTK. So if you'd like to purchase one for your graduate, please feel free to do so. I'm also told that the bookstore is open this afternoon as you complete the ceremonies and you a last chance to pick up some Cleveland State memorabilia. I can't see my page. I hope you have noticed the flags on the stage. We have four students from four countries other than the United States graduating today. These flags represent the graduates in the countries of Ghana, Guatemala, India, and Nigeria. For this fall, we received an intent to graduate forms from 279 students for degrees and certificates. Of those 279, 151 are female, 128 are male. This includes Associate of Arts, Associate of Science, Associate of Applied Science, and certificates. The average age of our graduates this fall is 28 years. 50% of our graduates come from Bradley County, 18% from McMinn County, 4 from Monroe, 6% from Polk County, 5 from Meigs, and 5 from other counties, including Hamilton County. We have also successfully awarded 6 degrees using the new reverse transfer program that was created this past February. This program allows students that transfer from a community college before they've earned their 2-year degree to retroactively receive that credential when requirements are met in pursuit of a bachelor's degree. The reverse transfer program has 30 colleges and universities across the state that are participating, and Tennessee is one of about 6 states in the country creating reverse transfer programs on this scale. And now I want to introduce our speakers for today. We began a new tradition last year to allow our distinguished staff and faculty members to serve as speakers at the fall commencement. So we have 2 keynote speakers this morning. Our first speaker is Ruth Kirkendall. She's admissions operations manager here at the college and also the recipient of our Distinguished Staff Award that is presented each year to an individual who has performed meritorious service to Cleveland State above and beyond the expectations of the job. This year's recipient has been with Cleveland State for 7 years. She was hired and has stayed with Student Services as an admissions coordinator and has become one of the first people that students interact with when wanting to enroll at Cleveland State. She takes great pride in working with students and performs her job extremely well. She was the lone admissions coordinator in the area for 3 months while 2 positions were vacant. She took this in stride and never hesitated to give it her all to make sure every application was done in a timely manner. She spent countless hours coming in early, staying late and working on weekends to make sure every student was taken care of. She did not do this for the money. She did it because of her dedication to students, her job, and her love for Cleveland State. She is always willing to and eager to learn more about her area and annually attends conferences and webinars to make sure she stays on top of the constant changes in her profession. She is the ultimate team player and loves to help out across the campus, serving on multiple committees and volunteering to serve as a host at almost every event. She has a heart for serving and always putting others ahead of herself. She is actively involved in her community church, volunteers on weekends at the Spring City Nursing Home, providing worship, and provides meals for people in her community that do not have or cannot join their family during Thanksgiving and Christmas. Living in Ray County, she is a great ambassador for Cleveland State outside of our service area. One thing is for sure, when you come into contact with Ruth, you walk away knowing how much she loves Cleveland State because that's who she is. Please help me welcome Ruth Kirkendall to the podium. That's right, you're up here.
Wow, I'm not a speech maker, you'll find that out, but good morning, graduates, families, friends, and colleagues. Oh, it's a special day, and we are so proud of you. I am so proud of you. I'm a big fan of old movies, and especially musicals, and as I was preparing for this speech, it occurred to me that if you've ever seen My Fair Lady, after Henry Higgins and Colonel Pickering take Eliza Doolittle to the royal banquet, and she is assumed that she's royalty after being just a flower girl. She comes back to the house, and they all start singing, "You did it! You did it! Indeed, you did it!" And that's what you've done. You've done it. You have made a huge accomplishment. You have obtained your degree or a certificate. You did it. You're here, and you're awesome, and we're so proud of you. Everyday things, as I know, get in our way when we accomplish even the most menial tasks. To complete anything at all, especially completing your education, is a huge investment in your time, in your energy, your finances, but you didn't let anything stop you. I am one of those students who completed their associate's degree at a community college before I went on to a university. So I know what you've accomplished, and it is huge. Many who start the endeavor never finish it. They never get what you've done. You have the initiative to follow through with what you started, and that makes you unique. There's not a large percentage of people who do that. You figured out what you wanted, and when you leave here today, I want you to celebrate you. Celebrate your success. You've done it. I've had the pleasure to work with some of you, whether it's on the phone or completing documents, and you've called because you just want to be sure everything's running smoothly behind the scenes, because I know when you're in classes, you're way too busy to worry about what's happening with your records. And I am always there to help, and am so glad that you got this far. In the end, you did it. You made the system work for you, and you're going to reap the benefits. Going back, I remember my last semester before I got my bachelor's degree. I had taken 20 hours of coursework because I didn't want to go that extra semester. And the last semester can seem so long, so difficult, and sometimes it's not long enough because there's just more that you want to accomplish. I was an adult, though, with a family, husband, three children, cats, dogs, goats, chickens, geese, and some horses, and I even had a race horse that was in need of medical attention, and so I was constantly taking him out in the yard, and he followed me around like a dog does, and wanted to come in the house. So I had a lot of pull on my time, to say the least. So here I was in my last semester of college. And of course, I still had to find out how to get my homework done, how to get my studies done. And I'm the kind of person that just had to get an A, so it wasn't like I could just forget about getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning to do my homework. So I arrived at school one day about a month into the semester, and I took a deep breath, parked in front of the administration building, and burst into tears. I thought, what the heck was I thinking? How can I do this? So, thankfully, God gave me a whop on the head and said, you started it, you're gonna finish it. And so, I know that He strengthened me, and I persevered, and I did it. And you have done the same. You have finished. You did it. You may have plans to continue now and go on to college or university, and I hope you do. You've come this far, and your possibilities are endless. Your future is bright, and you are strong. Don't let anyone say, I won't. Or I can't. Climb that ladder of success and say, I can and I will and I did. Finally, from this day forward, know that the world is filled with endless possibilities for you. Admit to yourself that what your desires are. Work hard and never give up on yourself. The world needs you. They need your minds. You need to go out and solve the problems of the world because we need you to be part of the solution to those problems. Don't shrink from risks and make sure you tune out the critics because there will be some. I used to tell my students, can't is not a word. Don't even try to find it in the dictionary. Give the world the positive attitude that you have shown in the completion of your goals, and work hard toward your future goals. Finally, I wish the best of everything for you. Go out and make it happen. Celebrate you. I'm so proud of you. You are so awesome. And thank you for letting me be part of that process.
I think she made a mistake by saying up front that she wasn't a speaker. She did a marvelous job. Thank you so much, Ruth. Our second speaker this morning is Mark McLeod. Mark received the Distinguished Faculty Award in May. This award is given each year to a member of the Cleveland State faculty in recognition of meritorious service to the college and community. He is an outstanding instructor who is always willing to go the extra mile for his students. As the only full-time professor within his discipline, he serves not only as an instructor, but also as a mentor to his students. In order to ensure that his students can meet their academic goals, he puts in long hours, providing extra instruction as well as independent study opportunities when necessary. He strives to provide students with easy access to educational materials through his creation of a digital textbook, which is free to the students and a model for his fellow faculty members. He provides students with an opportunity to begin their career in art by arranging shows for both current students and graduates. He works tirelessly to provide travel opportunities in order to provide students with cultural experiences they might not otherwise be able to have. Over the past 7 years, he has worked on fundraisers that brought in over $40,000 to help finance student trips to galleries in New York, Atlanta, and Knoxville. In addition, he has secured grants to bring in international artists in residency who provide our students with access to cutting-edge artistic techniques, as well as expert feedback and advice. In addition to serving as our current Faculty Senate President, he's also very active on campus committees and has served as the chairperson of the Cultural Enrichment Committee for 5 years, as well as the Textbook Task Force, the Compensation Task Force, and the Employee Evaluation Task Force. In addition, he has demonstrated a record of service to our community, having served, among other things, a frequent representative from Cleveland State as an art judge at various youth events. Please welcome Mark McLeod to the podium.
Morning. These types of speeches have a very traditional format. Some older person, me, tries to give heartfelt advice to a group of shining, energetic younger people. One useful thing you can do with an older person, in addition to borrowing money from them, or asking them to do one of their old-timey dances, is to ask them, looking back, what would you do differently? A pretty common response is that they say they would have traveled more, maybe worked a little less, maybe spent more time with family. Maybe they would have went to college or worked a job they really love instead of one that just paid the bills. I'd argue that most would say that they wish they would have spent more time pursuing their passions, their desires. The front porch of my South Carolina home faced a two-lane road that separated our yard from a field full of cows. My brother and I would spend our mornings trying to feed the cows through the electric fence while we waited on the bus to take us to school. I was sitting on the porch swing one afternoon trying to guess the color of the next car to come down the road. This was a game we played since we didn't have cable and our Nintendo was broken. I think the next one will be a green car. It was an 18-wheeler bound for the oddly named Piggly Wiggly that would be my first job as a bag boy. The next one was a blue truck. It was my dad, and he was home much earlier than usual. I stood there in the driveway waiting for what felt like an eternity for him to get out. When he finally did, he was wearing his blue jeans and his blue collared shirt, and I jokingly asked why he was home so early, if he had been fired. His answer was yes. We were never rich, but that summer we were the poorest of my friends. My mom used to take me and my brother to the law office where she worked, where we'd play with a copier scanning each other's faces until her boss came in and told us to knock it off. We'd wait until he left and then do it again. We'd scan each other's faces, pull them out of the copier as they were warm, and then draw on top of them. My dad had started out as a machinist while he was in high school, slowly working his way up to a part-time engineer, part-time sales position. This summer, though, would be different. My mom had just quit her job to go back to college, and my dad had just lost his. So my mom started making our clothes. We'd have something new to wear to school. I grew up in the 80s, when Ninja Turtles and MacGyver was cool. So were the words rad and gnarly, that's spelt with a G at the front. Unfortunately, growing up in the 80s meant that the popular clothes were the most brightest, pattern-infested things that you could imagine. Shorts were called jams, if that tells you anything. Jams, like this is my jam. My shorts were made from fabric that would make Cyndi Lauper and MC Hammer jealous. If you're too young to know who those two are, imagine Miley Cyrus covered in rainbows and glitter. She would use some of the leftover fabric to make a pocket on my shirt and then cover up the seams with puff paint, neon puff paint. Life was difficult. The company my dad was laid off from had hired a new manager to come in and make budget cuts. Over the next few years, he laid off more than half of the employees, some with 15 to 20 years invested in the company. We first sold our boat, and then our mom's car, and then when things got really bad, we sold off a piece of property that my dad was hoping to use to build us a house on. For the next several months, my brother and I would ride the bus home from school and then spend the rest of the evening with my dad at the county library. We would play in the kids' room while he would stack up books on the tables in the adult room. The kids' room was separated by glass windows, and I remember looking out of those windows and watching him read book after book after book. I spent hours watching him read through those books, and he was taking notes on old yellow legal pads. I found out later that only a few months after my dad was let go, he called one of his former biggest customers in Detroit and asked to represent them as an independent sales agent. They told him that they weren't sure and that they'd get back to him, but he persisted. He told them he wanted to talk to them in person and that he'd be there at 9 a.m. He drove all night from South Carolina to Michigan so that he could stand in their Detroit office the next morning. They signed a contract with McLeod Sales Company that day. We had been going to the library every night so that my dad could research how to start his own business. McLeod Sales was started in the summer of 1993. I was 13, and he was in direct competition with his former employer. My dad never graduated from college. His mother, my grandma, my granny, had an eighth grade reading level. Aside from a lack of education, what my dad did have was an unparalleled work ethic and his desire to lead. He was on the road for weeks at a time, going door to door, convincing his former customers to do business with his new company. He read machining magazines to find potential leads. He called and left voice messages on our home answering phone so that he could practice his sales pitch. That summer, he paid me a nickel for every invoice I filed. I would file these while him and a neighbor were setting up an office space in our garage. When he'd get home from being on the road all day, I'd have all his invoices neatly stacked up in yellow and white piles. His sales company would become one of the largest suppliers of machine parts in the Southeast and his former employer's biggest competition. He was now generating more revenue than the company that had let him go almost 15 years ago. In 2008, McLeod's sales company would put the business that fired my dad out of business. So here we are at a college graduation, and I'm telling you about how a man without an education made it. I'm still not sure what made him think that he could take on one of the largest parts manufacturers in the Southeast. But what I am sure of is that he had a desire for leadership and also enjoyed a little competition. You can be the most educated or experienced person in the room, but if you're not passionate about what you do, if you don't desire to do something more than the day in and day out, you will never be satisfied. The philosopher Alan Watts said that students would often come up to him and say, "We're getting out of college and we don't have the faintest idea of what to do." So he asked them, "What would you do if money were no object?" Crowds of students will say, "Well, we'd like to be painters, we'd like to be poets, we'd like to be writers." But as everybody knows, you can't make any money that way. Another person says, "Well, I'd like to live an out-of-doors life. I'd like to ride horses." He asks, "Is that what you really want to do?" When they finally got down to what the individual really wants to do, he looks at them and he says, "You do that and forget the money." If you say that getting the money is the most important thing, you will spend your life completely wasting your time. You'll be doing things you don't like doing in order to go on living. That is, to keep on doing things you don't like doing. It is better to have a short life that is full of what you like doing than a long life spent in a miserable way. The nurses in the audience don't desire to poke people with needles. At least I hope not. They desire to heal. The faculty here don't go home all excited about grading piles of papers. We're only able to get through it by an almost illegal amount of chocolate and caffeine. We desire to see a student light up when they get it. We desire to figure out how to reach every student, from those who may struggle with reading to those who have no problem making all A's. The artists and writers here, they don't desire to spend their time learning how to paint a sunset or conjugate a verb. They desire to express fundamental ideas about humanity, its pain, its joy, its sorrow, in ways that make us see the beauty in life. Both my bachelor's and master's degrees are in sculpture. If you want to choose a field that is almost completely unemployable, there you go. After undergrad, I moved back home with my parents and spent a year working at a frame shop. It was good money. It was actually more than I make now, but I wasn't happy. I convinced the owner of a bakery to rent me the space he owned next door for $50 a month. I spent that year making art almost every day and night, along with eating my fair share of pastries. I'd come home from work and go straight to the studio, sometimes staying well past midnight. At the end of the year, I had a brand new body of work, and so I sent out 5 graduate school applications. I got into 4, and 3 of them offered me a full ride. I didn't know what I was going to do with an art degree. Call it being naive, but I didn't choose art because it would make me a living. I chose art because I couldn't live without it. The philosopher Descartes wrote that the passion of desire is an agitation of the soul, a longing for something that's missing. Buddhism says that nirvana can be achieved by satisfying these cravings. Troilus tells Cressida in Shakespeare's play that this is the monstrosity in love, that the will is limitless, but the execution confined, that desire is boundless. Human desire, in other words, is infinite. Your education is much more than a piece of paper that you're about to receive. It is one more way to help you satisfy that desire. Thank you. Congratulations.
Mark, you are indeed an artist. Thank you for painting that picture of inspiration and motivation. Thank you very much. At this time, we'll have another selection from the Cleveland State Choir.
Don't.
As I call Dr. King forward to help me confer degrees, I want to remind everybody that we have a professional photographer taking pictures of each graduate. So we'd like to ask that all family and friends stay in the stands during the ceremony and remain until all graduates have exited the gym. Dr. King.
Dr. Seymour, I am pleased to present to you the graduating class of 2015. Will the graduates please stand? As Vice President for Academic Affairs, I certify that the students have fulfilled all of the requirements set forth by the Tennessee Board of Regents and that they are entitled to receive the appropriate degrees or certificates.
With the power vested in me by the Tennessee Board of Regents and the State of Tennessee, and upon recommendation of the faculty and administration of Cleveland State Community College, these graduates are hereby awarded an Associate of Arts degree, an Associate of Science degree, an Associate of Applied Science degree, or a certificate with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations. And now we'll commence with the conferring of degrees.
The first diploma will be presented by Dr. Vera Norwood, Associate Professor of Chemistry, Amy Beth Norwood. James Mark Allen. Nadia Bergovsky. Shelby Nicole Brock. Kenny Lee Kane. Laura Teresa Chrisman. Charles Thomas Collins. Alyssa Sierra DeBoard. Allison Lachey Durham. Haley Nicole Ellis. Sierra Macy Ellison. Amber Sky Hudson. Carrie Kirkpatrick. Sarah Denise Kuhn. Shelby Marie Llewellyn. Yeah. Sarah Catherine McGuffey. Peyton Bailey Nunley. Cassandra K. Paget. Delisa Nicole Smith. Jonathan William Henry Smith. Carly Rihanna Stanley. Valerie Nicole Trentham. Daniel Jared Vincent. Tiffany Maria Widener. Michael Ralph Betancourt. Taylor Renee Bowen. Anthony David Brown. John H. Brown. Clark Edward Bryant. Stephen Brooks Bryant. Carmen Michelle Bryson. Donna C. Burns. Tasha Lee Kane. Amanda F. Carden. Amber Lynn Chambers. Eva Marie Coleman. Lindsay Renee Cooper. James M. Creech. Kathy Elaine Edwards. April Michelle Elkins. Joshua Glenn Hall. Brian R. Hidalgo. Shams Hirani. Kimberly Benet Holmes. Allison Noel Holt. Sean Michael Hunter. Elizabeth Victoria Calabas Miller. Nathan Grant Kirkland. Michelle Dawn Knox. Amy Elizabeth McCulley. Stephen Ucheka Megadolblu. Sally Deanne Sanders. Debbie Ann Selby. Loy Andrea Shepherd. Taylor Marie Somero. Stephanie Marie Sparks. Sherry Danette Trinkner. Jennifer Diane Webb. Joseph A. Westerfield. Lori Rebecca Womack. Kimberly Ann Ziegler. Taiwo Benjamin Adiko. Michelle L. Anderson. Dalton Marie Bellia. Shelby Nicole Grimes. Natalia Istomin. Marina Renee Schell. Benton Tompkins. Jacob Anthony Vincent.
Will all the graduates please stand? This is that time in the ceremony where you move your tassels to the left. You are now officially graduates of Cleveland State Community College. Now that you are alumni, please continue to consider yourself a part of the Cleveland State family, and please, please keep in touch. Please have a seat. This is the spot in the program where the president gets to provide closing remarks, a point of executive privilege, I guess, the last words you receive as part of your college experience here at Cleveland State. I understand that I am what stands between you and leaving here and commencing the rest of your life, or at least going to lunch with your family and friends. I do, however, want to take a moment to say thank you. So, thank you. You might be wondering, why is he thanking us? I want to thank you because you have made a positive and lasting mark on Cleveland State. You have made us a better place, a better campus family for being with us. It just hit me, folks. I'm not sure why. This is a happy occasion. You are the fulfillment of our mission, so each one of you that crossed this stage is a celebration of us completing our mission. So not only do we celebrate with you, we thank you for the honor of serving you. We are a community college, and you are our community. That is why we believe in putting community first in all that we do. I also think it's special that you receive your degree during this special season of the year. I've heard it said many times that this is the season of perpetual hope. My greatest hope for you is that you have learned through your experience here that you can hope for just about any achievement that you can dream and actually make it happen. You all have demonstrated that you have the skills and dedication to set goals and to achieve them. Whether you are moving on to that dream job or the next phase of your education, I hope you move on with a sincere belief that you will be extremely successful, because you will. We are so very proud of you and wish you and your families the very best. And from our family to yours, we wish you a very Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, and a bright and prosperous New Year. Thank you very much. In honor of our graduating class of 2015, we ask that you refrain from exiting the building during the recessional. You may meet your graduate outside the gym once they have exited. Thank you for your assistance in this manner. So now it is time for the recessional. Here we go, folks.